Hi, I'm State Senator Kevin Parker, and welcome to a report from the State Senate. As you know, I represent the 21st District in Brooklyn, which is Flatbush and East Flatbush, Midwood, Ditmas Park, Kensington, and Borough Park. One thing that really unites all of the different segments of my district, as well as the different parts of our state, is the issue of education. Everybody wants to have a quality education for their child. Everybody understands that education is not just a key to the door of opportunity, but it's a sledgehammer to knock it down, as State Controller Carl McCall used to say. And today I'm very excited to have a good friend and someone who knows a great deal about these issues is Steve Allinger, the Director of Legislation for the New York United Teachers. Thank you, Steve, for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
Good, good. So, Steve, you've been at NYSET for a little while.
Right, five years. Okay. Over 5 years.
And were you always the Director of Legislation?
No. For 11 prior years, I was Executive Director of Intergovernmental Affairs for New York City Schools.
Okay. And so you've kind of worked in made your bones in education,
yes,
as they say around here.
Worked for the state legislature, at one time for Governor Cuomo on an education reform commission. So
the first Governor Cuomo?
Yes.
Nice. So tell me, what's so, for you, from your perspective personally, why is education such a committed issue for you?
Well, for me, it's a social justice issue. I feel it's the best program ever invented for upward mobility, for equal opportunity, that it's a way into the mainstream and the middle class for low-income people. It is a great equalizer, and it's done a lot for me and my family and, my forebears. And it's really almost a bedrock. It's a bedrock of our democracy. If you talk about equal opportunity and equal protection under the law, education is central to the American dream.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. It's absolutely critical. And you actually, what's interesting about education as a public policy person, mm-hmm. Education is one of the things that has the greatest number of what they call externalities, like third party and fourth
That's
party
right.
externalities. It's not just you get education, you get more income, but as you get education, you get more income. People who are better educated are typically better citizens, which means you're spending less money on things like criminal justice. People who are better educated also have better health outcomes, which is interesting.
Right.
In fact, what we find when we look at health disparities is mm-hmm. that the thing that actually beats health disparities is not income, it's not access to insurance, but actually education. People who are better educated know how to interact with their doctors even in a better way, to ask better questions and to make sure that they're being properly diagnosed and properly treated. So I totally agree with you. It's really a great equalizer.
And you help not just that individual you're educating, you help their siblings.
That's right.
You help their neighborhood,
right.
their community. They touch on many other lives. So there's these concentric circles of opportunity that ripples out from that individual.
So tell me a little bit about the union and what the function of NYSET is.
Well, NYSET has over 600,000 members in service and active retirees in K-12, in state universities, city university, almost all the community colleges, and in some healthcare institutions, hospitals. So we're a diverse union of professionals. We're focused on improving the quality of the work life. We're very dedicated to educational opportunity, both in K-12 higher education. And we're very committed to closing the achievement gap and making sure that education is excellent and accessible for all New Yorkers.
Right. So your job as the Director of Legislation for NYSET is to be up here and talk to people like me.
Advocate.
Yes. And particularly to pay attention to both the legislative agendas as it relates to education mm-hmm. and things related to education, as well as the budget.
Right.
Right now, we're in the middle of the budget cycle. People tired of hearing me talk about the fact that we have the third largest budget in the entire country.
That's right.
And a larger part of it is education.
Right.
Yeah, can you talk about NYSET's perspective on this year's state budget?
Well, we feel we are in a better starting position than we have 3 years. The record economic recession that we had, the worst since the Great Depression, cost 3 years of contraction. Mm-hmm. And we've lost over 30,000 educators' positions, 11,400 this year alone.
Wow.
7,500 of those were through layoffs. Mm-hmm. So we've been through an incredibly tough bottleneck the last 3 years. And one of the things we're thankful to you for and your colleagues is that in December of 2011, just a few months ago, you were able to pass a partial extension of the millionaire's tax that helped close a $3.5 billion looming budget deficit that would have probably made it very difficult to turn around this disinvestment in education. So now we're looking, instead of a $1.3 billion cut, as we were last year, at an $805 million increase. However, we're not out of the woods. $250 million of that increase would be stripped out for competitive grants and taken away from a need-based formula that you and others have fought for over a decade through the Campaign for Fiscal Equity. And so we want the $250 million that's in the budget put back into formula aid focused on the neediest schools and to rebuild the programs that kids need to succeed.
So how much of the actual state budget is education in dollars or percentage?
It's roughly, it's over 20%.
Right. Okay.
Right now it's about $20 billion.
About $20 billion,
of
right.
The state's general fund.
And there's an addition, and that includes the additional almost $800 million that's being put in. Well, let's
correct.
Say 500.
It fell under 20 billion. Right. $2.7 billion was cut.
Right.
Since 2009. So this begins to repair the damage.
Right.
In the governor's budget puts back about $1 out of every $5 that was cut, and that's why we want to redirect the competitive grants into base aid through a progressive formula that recognizes needs of students.
Yeah, my last show I actually had Frank Murrow from mm-hmm. The Fiscal Policy Institute. He actually talked about the same issue.
Yeah,
I mean, and really thought that, you know, if the governor wants to do, you know, competitive grants, great, but he ought to come up with additional dollars to do those competitive grants. Let the $800 million stand as part of the base aid formula, and then if he wants to do $250 million of competitive grants, let him find an additional $250 million to do competitive
right.
grants. But we really need to stop the erosion that has happened over the last, you know, four or
right.
5 years with education. With
yeah,
this,
we're very increase. Worried about the impact on high-need schools. For instance, in New York City, they've lost over 7,000, about 7,500 educators mm-hmm. since 2009. Class sizes are going in the wrong direction. We're seeing in elementary grades, class sizes that were supposed to, we're trying to get them down to 20-1, have gone back on average to 26-1.
And why
in the
is class
early
size,
grades.
Why is class size important?
Class size is important for getting kids a good start in literacy, in mathematics, to make sure that they have the tools for higher learning, you know, for more advanced learning. Mm-hmm. They need the individualized attention. Kids have different learning styles. You have to customize your teaching approach to reach all kids, and that's extraordinarily difficult to do in an overcrowded class, and it creates much more difficult classroom management situations. And there are a lot of classes in New York, thousands of them, that are now supersized, way over 30. Record class size grievances, and we're going in the wrong direction.
Right. Let's talk a little bit, speaking of going in the wrong direction, we fought for a number of years under the leadership of now Councilman Robert Jackson, who mm-hmm. began as a teacher and a parent and a member of the New York City School Board, around the issue of CFE, the Campaign for Fiscal Equity. And there was a number of lawsuits, and went to mm-hmm. the Supreme Court here in the state, won, you know, and then what happened? Yeah,
yeah,
the appellate court.
Court
so
of
what
appeals.
Happened? What now is happening with that money, and what should we be doing different here in the state?
Well, we should restart the foundation formula. Mm-hmm. In 2007, the legislature and the governor settled the CFE lawsuit, and the court had opined that it could be a statewide settlement, and that's what indeed was done. And in 2007, there was over a $7 billion commitment based on a cost study of what it costs to provide a sound and basic education in every school in the state. Right. In the first 2 years, it was quite successful. It was funded in 2007-08 and 2008-09. And what it did is allowed moderate and low-income districts to provide real dollar investments in strategies to close the achievement gap. And strategies like academic intervention services, better curriculum, targeted class size reduction. And it wasn't money for nothing. There was a requirement that in struggling schools that they have a contract for excellence and show how they were going to use the additional dollars and be held accountable for the additional money. So it was more money, more accountability for results, and we feel it was an excellent law. But in 2009, it was suspended and cut and then cut again. First it was frozen and then cut for 2 years. And we're well behind, and we believe that the state needs to reaffirm its commitment, restart the formula, and put real dollar investment into these strategies, because we're holding students and teachers to higher standards, but we're not providing the resources they need to reach them.
Yeah, that's critically important. I mean, what we found initially when we first started this lawsuit, that New York City school children were actually receiving $2,000 less per child than every other child in the state of New York. But as we looked out further, a number of us said, look, this is not just a New York City problem, that we really want to be looking at out for high school, high need school districts, right, from Buffalo to Bath, from Brookhaven to Brooklyn, to make sure that every child has, you know, an adequate education. And so, you know, we're continuing to be committed to that, and I'm certainly going to be advocating on the behalf of the
We've appreciated your longstanding support for these issues. You've been a champion of school equity, and we're all through this long campaign for equity in schools, we've been very appreciative of your leadership.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And I think the governor has done a great job at balancing the budget, but we can't balance that budget on the backs of school children. And it's critical that we make sure that education, which is so important for everybody, gets funded first. You know, I say budgets all the time are about priorities, right? They're not about numbers. And so it's more important that we fund our priorities than it is about the fact that we balance it at the end. And we can do both, right? We can do both. As we start to wrap up, I just really want a quick we both share something else. I'm the ranking member on energy and telecommunication. Mm-hmm. I lead the Democratic Task Force on Alternative Energy. In about a minute, just talk a little bit about green schools and what we're doing in that area.
Well, we believe that that schools should be exemplars of sustainability, energy conservation, and that they should build in learning opportunities for students to learn about environmental stewardship. The green schools, which are built to what's called a LEED standard, and I think in New York City, new schools are required to be built to a silver LEED standard. They're more healthful. You have lower absenteeism. You have opportunities for green space and recreation, and it saves a tremendous amount of money. I think in the limited amount of green school investment in New York City, since 2009, they've saved over 11% in fuel costs at a time when you have energy prices skyrocketing. So we think it's a win-win. It's a win financially in lowering long-term operating costs. It's great for kids. They have a more healthy learning environment. They achieve better. And it also sets an example for the rest of society that we have to lower our carbon footprint. We have to battle climate change. We have to create healthful recreational opportunities for children and adults in our communities.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. And certainly we're looking forward to partnering together to do some legislation that's going to be important for that.
I follow avidly your leadership on energy issues.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve. Well, this has been a really interesting conversation, short although it may be, about education and particularly how important it is for the state of New York. I want to thank my guest and my friend today, Steve Allinger, and the folks at NYSET for their leadership on this issue. And just want people to reach out to me if they have issues or comments or questions or concerns about the issue of education or anything that you think I could be helpful with. Until next time, I'm State Senator Kevin Parker, and this is a report from the State Senate.